Once again, my greetings to all of you. We will be discussing about the characteristic features of Middle English language in this video. Firstly, talking about the spelling and pronunciation. In Old English, if you remember, the letter F represented the voiceless sound F and also the voiced sound V. Middle English scribes used the letter V for the voiced variety and the letter F for the voiceless sound. These scribes were, however, not very particular about the shape of letter V, and so they wrote it either like V or like U. In Old English, the letter S was pronounced as S in certain position and Z in certain other positions. But in Middle English, scribes discontinued this practice and letter S was used for the voiceless sound S and the letter Z for the voiced sound Z. If you remember, when we were discussing about the characteristic features of Old English language, the letters thorn and eth were used for the sounds th and t. These two letters were discarded and replaced by th during the Middle English period. The letter eth continued about the end of 12th century and the letter thorn continued until the end of the 13th century, and then they disappeared forever. In Old English, the letters SC were used for the sound SH. Middle English scribes started using SS, SCH or SH in place of the Old English SC. So, the Old English word FISC, fish, for example, in Middle English was written as FISS, FISCH or FISH, fish. In Old English, the letters CG were used for the sound J. But in Middle English, this sequence of letters was slowly replaced by I, J or G. So, in Middle English, the modern English word judge was not written with CG. It was written as IUGE or as JUGE. In Old English orthography, the letter C represented two different sounds, the velar stop K and palatal stop CH. Middle English scribes used either K or C for the velar stop K, but they started using CH for the palatal stop, that is CH. The modern English kin were written as KINKIN, and cool was written as COL, but chin was written as CHINN. In Old English, the letter Y represented a vowel sound, but this vowel sound was discarded by most dialects of Middle English. The letter Y was retained as an alternative form of letter I. For example, KING King and KYNG King were two alternative spellings of the same word with same pronunciation. In Old English, the short vowel I and also the long vowel E was represented by E, but in Middle English, double E and IE were used for the pronunciation E. For example, Old English word queen was written as QUEE and queen, and FELD field was written as FIELD field. In many words, the vowel preceding consonant cluster LD, MD and ND were lengthened and in many cases lengthening meant the diphthongization of the vowel. For example, the old English word child, C-I-L-D, became C-H-I-L-D, child. C-Y-N-D-E became K-I-N-D, kind, and C-L-I-M-B-A-N became C-L-I-M-B, climb. One of the changes that took place in the phonetic structure of words during the Middle English period was the metathesis of R. Metathesis, that is the transpositions of sound or letters in a word. For example, the Old English BRID, bird, was changed into BIRD, and FOST, frost, changed into FROST, frost. The Middle English period is characterized by the loss of a number of consonants. It took place in two different forms. The consonant continued to exist in a word but dropped out of the spoken form of that word. For example, TWA changed into TWO2 and HWA changed into WHO, who. In some cases, it was excluded from the written shape of the word. For example, EALSWA changed into ALSO also, and SWEOSTOR changed into SUSTER, that is the modern word sister. Now, talking about the grammatical features, Old English was a synthetic language, as we discussed when we were discussing about the characteristic features of Old English language, and the grammatical relationship between the words in an Old English sentence was understood on the basis of the inflections and not on the basis of the position of the word occupied in a sentence. The inflections of Middle English became weak during the 12th century. By the end of the Middle English period, these inflections were more or less fully replaced by the prepositions from the point of view of their function. The word order became a grammatical necessity and was no longer a matter of stylistic preference. There were changes in the rules of pronunciations, spellings, pronunciations, etc. This was the period of radical changes, a period in which a synthetic language changed into an analytic language. Now, talking about nouns, in Old English, the plural of certain nouns was formed by adding as and an at the end. For example, stanas, stanas was the plural form of stan, stan, that is the modern word stone, and huntan, hunter, was the plural form of hunta, hunter, that is hunter. In modern English, the addition as gave rise to s and an gave rise to en. For example, stones, churches, children, etc. During the first half of the Middle English period, s and es were the usual devices for forming plurals in the northern dialects of Old English. For example, engles, that is angels, and eyes, eyes. In the southern dialects of Old English, during Middle English, en was extensively used for forming plurals. For examples, engleen, that is angels, and eyen. By the 15th century, s and es displaced en all over England and became accepted as the general suffixes for forming plurals in English. Now, talking about adjectives, during the first half of the Middle English period, adjectives had two forms. The marked singular form, for example, fair, fair, and the unmarked plural form with an e at the end, for example, fair, fair. Chaucer used the expressions like the weather is fair, that is, you can see the weather is fair, fair, and fair waves. Here you can see it is fair, that is, fair waves. Towards the end of the Middle English period, the e at the end of plural adjectives was lost and adjectives in English became indeclinable. From the point of view of the formation of comparative and superlative, adjectives in Middle English were basically of three different types as they are in modern English. Adjectives in the case of which the comparative and the superlative are formed by adding er and est. Adjectives in the case of which the comparative and the superlative are formed by prefixing more and most. Adjectives in the case of which the comparative and the superlative forms are based on different roots than the positive. Old English had GRET great, GRETTER greater, and GRETTEST greatest. But Middle English had GRETER greater and GRETEST greatest, formed directly from the positive great. Old English had old, elder, eldest. But Middle English formed its own comparative and superlative forms, like older and oldest, directly from the positive form old. Old English had late, later, and last, but Middle English formed its own comparative and superlative forms, that is, later, later, and latest, directly from late. Now, moving on to articles, during the Middle English period, the Old English SE was used before singular masculine nouns and SEO was used before singular feminine nouns were changed into THE, the, which could be used before all kinds of nouns, same as in modern English. Now, moving on to pronouns, in Old English, ye, ye was plural of thou and you was the plural of thee. But in Middle English period, thee and thou were used in case of children, familiars, and for the persons of an inferior status. Ye and you were the words of respect and were used while addressing a superior. It was during the Middle English period that the modern English pronoun she came into use for the first time. In Old English, min, min was the genitive form of the first person singular pronoun and din, din was the genitive form of the second person singular pronoun. In Middle English, mi and di were used if the following word began with a consonant, and min and din were used if the following word began with a vowel. Now, talking about gender, in Middle English, natural gender asserted itself more and more, and by the second half of the Middle English period, grammatical gender was more or less completely replaced by natural gender. The cumbersome system of grammatical gender of Old English was increasingly simplified and then was almost abandoned during the Middle English period. Now, finally, moving on to verbs, from the point of view of their inflectional potential, verbs in Middle English can be studied in relation to three persons. two persons, singular and plural, but no dual. Two tense forms, the present and the past. It distinguished three moods, that is the indicative, the subjunctive and the imperative. Verbs in Middle English had no passive form. The passive form of verbs emerged during the modern English period. Talking about shall and will, in Old English, I see wille, that is I see wille, meant I wish to, and I see she, that is I see scheal, meant I am obliged to. The meaning of shall and will with the reference to the future time became established during the Middle English period. Now, talking about strong and weak verbs, you should not be trapped with the words strong and weak here. The very first thing which comes in our mind when we hear these words, that is strong and weak, is that strong dominates over weak. But here in this case, strong verbs struggled to survive, whereas weak verbs survived during Middle English period, but strong verbs depleted. Weak verbs are those which are amenable to a regular formation of the past tense and the past participle by the addition of D and ED. Because of the regularity in the pattern, they are also known as regular verbs. Those verbs which do not conform to this pattern for the formation of the past or past participle forms have always been labeled as strong or irregular verbs. Because of the irregularity, the strong verbs turned out to be an encumbrance, and as a result, they depleted. Nearly one third of the strong verbs in existence at that time fell out of use. On the other hand, the strong verbs which survived in this struggle for existence changed from strong verbs to weak verbs. For example, ek was originally a strong verb with oak, oke, oak as its past tense form, which changed to weak verb, that is ached. Similarly, climb, creep, shave, yield were originally strong verbs with clomb, crop, shove and yold with the past tense form, but during Middle English period they developed weak form also. With this we come to the end of this video, and we'll be discussing about the dialects of Old English in the very next video. Thank you.